My name is Loretta Goodwin, and I'm a senior director at the American Youth Policy Forum. In case you're not familiar with AYPF, we're a nonpartisan, nonprofit organization, and we focus on providing professional learning opportunities for policymakers at the national, state, and local levels. We focus on a wide range of issues involving education, youth development, and workforce development. And through our events and convenings, we aim to help young people, especially those in underserved communities, to be successful in college, career, and beyond. You can find out more about our events and our resources at www.aypf.org. Before we discuss today's topic, I want to provide a few logistical points about the webinar. In the event of any technical difficulties, you may dial 1-800-263-6317 to reach GoToWebinar's technical support line. Also, if you happen to lose connectivity, please just go ahead and log back into the webinar. At any point during the webinar, you may type a question for our presenters in the questions box on your screen to the right, and we'll do our best to answer as many as we can. This webinar will be recorded, and the audio portion with all of the slides will be posted on the AYPF website. When you exit the webinar, you'll receive a very brief online survey about today's webinar and its value to you. I encourage you to fill that out and to please send us your feedback, as this really helps us to improve our programming. Today, we're also going to be live tweeting the event, and we encourage you to join us on Twitter. Our hashtag is #AYPFEvents. Moving to today's webinar. First, I'd like to acknowledge the William T. Grant Foundation, whose funding makes today's event possible. We know that state child welfare systems are a crucial component of the development of vulnerable youth, and especially those youth in foster care. These welfare systems, which in 2011 served 6.2 million children in the United States, are responsible for services tied to youth well-being, including the use of psychotropic medications for emotional and behavioral problems. However, the knowledge of research about recommended practices for appropriate use of medications varies greatly among child welfare professionals, and the ways in which research evidence is used differs widely across states and communities. This webinar today will focus on how mid-level policymakers in state child welfare agencies acquire, interpret, and use research evidence as they develop policies regarding the use of medications for young people in foster care, all with the goal of improving their life and their health outcomes. Responding to the dramatic increase in the use of these medications in recent years, the federal government mandated that all state child welfare agencies develop plans to review and manage behavioral health services for youth. Presenters during this webinar are going to explore various state and local responses to this federal charge and their engagement with research as they considered their options and developed plans. Our presenters today are, first of all, Laurel Leslie, the Vice President of Research at the American Board of Pediatrics. She's also at Tufts University School of Medicine. We'll then hear from Thomas Mackey, an assistant professor in the Department of Health Systems and Policy at Rutgers School of Public Health. We'll stop for some question and answers after Laurel and Tom's presentations. And then we'll move to hearing from Chris Belanchi, an associate professor at Tufts University School of Medicine. And finally, we'll hear about what's happening on the ground in New Jersey from Deb Lancaster, the director of the Office of Strategic Development in New Jersey's Department of Children and Families. So without further ado, I'd like to now turn the presentation over to Laurel Leslie and have her frame for us what this issue is.
Thank you very much. We're going to go to the next slide, and I wanted to just lay out for you what the objectives are for this webinar. The four of us will each be taking one of these separate four questions and answering them for you. The first question is there evidence, and I'll be focusing on research evidence, that we should be concerned about children in foster care and the use of psychotropic medications? We'll then move to what evidence is available to inform state oversight of psychotropic medication use, where the evidence is lacking, and how states have responded. We will then talk about how states are using their own local evidence collaboratively to measure medication use, and Deb Lancaster will then be talking about her state's experience. We can go to the next slide. I wanted to also just thank several of the funding agencies who have provided funding support for the research that we'll be discussing during this webinar. Next slide, please. Before we begin, I also wanted to define some terms. So what do we mean by children in foster care? Well, these are children who are removed from their homes and under the custody of the state. And I put this picture of Mary Ellen McCormick here in this slide just to remind us of how recently it's been that the concept of the state taking custody of children who are abused is. So Mary Ellen McCormick in 1874 was a young girl who was physically abused, and her neighbors were concerned about this and were unable to find a public health official to be able to report this or have any kind of action taken. And we're actually unable to find a lawyer as well until they went for a lawyer from the National Society of Prevention of Cruelty to Animals, who was actually advocating on behalf of horses who were misused when they were driving carriages. So we have about a 150-year history of acknowledging the state as really acting in locus parentis for those children who are abused to the point where it's deemed that it's unsafe for them to remain in their home. That abuse may include physical or sexual abuse, as well as emotional abuse or neglect. Psychotropic medications is another term I'll be using, which refers to those medications that are used for behavioral and emotional problems. A third term that I wanted to define is research evidence use, which is on the next slide. Research evidence use refers to empirical findings derived from systematic research methods and analyses. These can include different types of studies, be they descriptive studies, evaluation studies, or studies that are such as randomized clinical trials that are looking at interventions. They can use qualitative data, which comes from focus groups and interviews and other similar types of narrative data, or quantitative data, which tends to be more numerical data and uses statistical techniques to analyze it. They may include meta-analyses that are summaries of studies or cost-effectiveness studies. What we're also interested in finding out is that states and other groups are increasingly using research methods to look at their own administrative and local data, and we'll be talking some about that during this webinar. Next slide, please. So I was asked to answer the question, is there evidence from the research that we should be concerned about children in foster care and the use of psychotropic medications? Next slide. So that really leads me to ask, first of all, do children in foster care have mental health disorders that might warrant the use of psychotropic medication use? And we actually have very good epidemiological evidence about this. We know that the rates of mental health disorders are more common in foster care compared to children in community samples. We see rates of 50 to 80% versus 1 to 25% in different studies. This isn't all that surprising because these children are coming with a history of adverse childhood experiences, including abuse and neglect, domestic violence, poverty and the potential for resulting community violence exposure, and in utero and environmental drug exposure. We also know from adult studies that toxic stress in early childhood has been linked to adult health and mental health disorders. On the next slide is a diagram that comes from the ACEs study, which is the Adverse Childhood Experiences Study. There are over 200 publications now that are a part of this study examining the impact of adverse childhood experiences on adult health risk behaviors, social, emotional, cognitive functioning, disease and disability, and early death from disorders such as cancer and heart disease. Next slide. That these children do have mental health disorders. Well, is it something to worry about? What's the impact on the child? Well, we have good evidence that behavior problems actually are linked to their experience of placement while they're in out-of-home care. So we know that 20% of placement changes are related to behavior problems, in that the behavior problems are what foster parents have stated is the reason they're requesting a placement change. We also know that those children who have had multiple placements are more likely to go on to develop worsening behavior problems. and that youth with externalizing problems, which are acting out types of behaviors, are twice as likely to remain in foster care 18 months after entry. Next slide, please. So this is something to worry about in terms of the experience that children have while they're in the custody of the state. Well, what about costs of mental health care? Here we see three different bar graphs. The first one demonstrating all children in Medicaid in 2005, the second looking at behavioral health service use, and the third looking at expenses, with red indicating those children on Medicaid who are eligible for Medicaid because of their parents' income, orange indicating those children with SSI disability, and blue indicating those children in foster care. And we can see that behavioral health service use is much higher for children in foster care and for children in SSI, and costs more of the total Medicaid dollars in this slide. Next slide, please. Now, we might say, okay, children in mental and foster care have high rates of mental health disorders. It's clear that they're accessing services. What about medications? And this is one table from the REACH Institute. There are multiple tables like this developed by other organizations rating the different types of mental health disorders we see in children, the medications that are currently available, and their evidence base from A to D, with A being the highest. And you can see here that we actually have relatively decent evidence about a number of these medications in terms of their efficacy and in terms of their safety. Next slide, please. What else can we say about medication use among children in foster care? This is a similar data set using from the Center for Healthcare Strategies using data from 2013. And you'll see here we're having a comparison in the bar graphs between children on TANF, SSI, disability, and foster care among children in Medicaid. What we're noticing here is that children in SSI and disability and children in foster care have higher rates of concurrent psychotropic medication use, or what we might term polypharmacy, than children in Medicaid in general. Next slide, please. So we see then that there are four potential possibilities that we need to be concerned about for children in foster care. It could be that they're having appropriate use of medications. They have higher rates of mental health problems. They have higher rates of accessing services. They have higher rates of medication use. However, it could also be that we're seeing higher rates of medication use than might be seen as appropriate for the types of problems that they're dealing with, many of these being problems related to trauma. There may be misuse of medications where they're being misdiagnosed, and there may be, in fact, underuse. Let's take a closer look at these possibilities on the next slide. So when we look at the research evidence we have on psychotropic medication use among children in foster care, one of the things that we see across a number of studies is similar to the bar graphs I showed you. Children in the child welfare foster care system are much more likely to be using medications than children in community samples. Polypharmacy is also common. If we define that as three or more medications being used at the same time over 30 days, in one state, we had 41% of children in foster care who'd been there for over a year using three or more medications. Now, what's really concerning is when we start to see geographic variation. These are two studies looking at geographic variation using Medicaid claims data. One looked at differences across states with respect to using three or more medications, and you can see states varied, with children in foster care ranging from 0.5% to 13.6% using polypharmacy. And then when we look at children with a specific diagnosis, autism, we see a range of 5 to nearly 50% by states. This is concerning to us because this suggests that medication use is not necessarily tied to need, but that there are other factors driving the use. Next slide. There have been multiple studies that have said, well, if we control for clinical need, what other factors are impacting their use of psychotropic medications? And these are just some of the factors that have been demonstrated in those studies. The first is access to trained clinicians. The second is clinicians who are knowledgeable and have experience with trauma, or with the fact that many children in foster care have developed behaviors that worked for them in the setting where they were abused or neglected, but don't work for them in the current setting that they've moved into. These are maladaptive behaviors that they need help learning how to address. We know that children can't always access effective, evidence-based, non-pharmacological treatments, so medications end up being a treatment of last resort. And we know there are systems issues. There are gaps in coordination across the Medicaid, mental health, and child welfare sectors, as well as the educational sectors, and there's a lack of state oversight systems specifically looking at the needs of children in foster care. Next slide. I also wanted to share with you some narrative research data coming out of some studies that we did where we interviewed youth about their use of medication. This young man says, if I don't have the help I need, I won't be able to get my medicine and stuff. I need my medicine. If I don't have my medicine, I really have bad blow-ups. I try to hurt people or hurt myself or I destroy stuff. So I really need my medicine for that. Next slide. Compare that with this young lady. They told me if it ever made me sleepy, they'd take me off the antipsychotic medication because I'm a school person. I like to go to school. I like to learn. And for the simple fact it was making me fall asleep in school, I just felt like you're taking the fun out of my life because I love school. You're just taking the one thing I love out of my life. And I would tell the doctor the medications is making me fall asleep in class, and my teachers would tell them she's falling asleep a lot in class, and they still wouldn't take me off the medications. Next slide. So I think what we have are children in foster care who have multiple adults across multiple sectors engaged in their life. But there's no single adult in their lives who's acting the same way we anticipate that a parent will for children who are not in the foster care system. A parent who would be paying attention to medication use, collecting information from different sites, and determining if those medications were actually making a difference, and making sure the child was accessing other services as well. Next slide. That is, in fact, what led to the two passages of legislation in 2008 and 2011, requiring first that states develop oversight and coordination plans for health and mental health services, and then in 2011, developing protocols for psychotropic oversight by July of 2012. In 2012, the government also sponsored a Because Minds Matter summit where they convened representatives from Medicaid, mental health, and child welfare from 49 states in D.C. to come up with strategies for how they would develop oversight systems. We were lucky enough to be able to get funding at this point in time to be able to examine what states were doing, and I'd like to turn the podium over to my fellow researcher, Dr. Thomas Mackey, now to share a little bit about what we learned.
Hello, thank you, Dr.
Hello, thank you, Dr.
Today I'm going to be speaking to the second question of this webinar, which is what evidence is available to inform state oversight of psychotropic medication use and how states responded. So if we can take the next slide. And here we have the research evidence that has been provided by the federal government through the Government Accountability Office. They've issued three reports since 2011 that have specifically called attention to concern around the oversight of psychotropic medication prescribing for children in foster care and in some cases for children Medicaid enrolled more broadly. And these reports report from various data sources, but taken together and collectively have raised concern around both the rates of psychotropic medication prescribing for children in foster care as compared to other populations, highlighting the geographic variation that Dr. Leslie had mentioned earlier, as well as bringing concern to the potential for there to be inadequate availability of psychosocial therapies that may also contribute to and lend to concerns with regard to the use of these psychotropic medications, especially for this population of children who have experienced trauma both prior to and while in the foster care systems. Next slide, please. And we just following this, these reports as well as the federal legislation that have been mentioned earlier, we've conducted two studies that have looked at how states have been responding to these concerns around psychotropic medication prescribing, or that look at the state of the states. And this is really where our evidence is strongest with regard to state responses of psychotropic medication prescribing. There's relatively limited evidence about the effectiveness of these approaches, but we do know quite a bit about the types of approaches that states are taking, and this is what I'll focus attention on now. The first study, which occurred after the Fostering Connections and Increasing Success to Adoptions Act of 2008, really looked more broadly at the state policies and best practices that state had in place in response to that legislation. And the second study, which occurred following the enactment of the Child and Family Services Improvement and Innovation Act of 2011, looked more specifically at state policy and practices for psychotropic medication monitoring in particular, and also looked at the different types of information that states were using to respond to psychotropic medication concerns, and the types of collaborations that they had developed. We employed a number of different kinds of data for these analyses, relying on legislative and document reviews, as well as semi-structured interviews. In the second study, we also validated our findings with state-specific summary sheets for each of the states and DC. Next slide. And as you'll see in this figure, what we found from this work, the first of the two studies, is that states really have substantial variation with regard to their oversight policies, both for mental health evaluations as well as for psychotropic medication oversight more broadly. And over almost half of the 48 states, 47.9%, that were part of this study, had endorsed the mental health evaluation in either their policy or guidelines. And just over half of the 48 states in DC held policies and guidelines for psychotropic medication oversight, but there really was substantial variation with regard to the populations and the medications that were covered and in the mechanisms that were considered as part of the psychotropic medication oversight plan, whether that be informed consent, child, or population level monitoring. And just to note, about a quarter of the 48 states in DC reported no policy for mental health evaluation or oversight being in place back in 2009 and 10. In the next slide, we'll see that that states, as one might have expected from the previous, are really in different stages with regard to their implementation and the infrastructures they have in place for providing psychotropic medication monitoring. This can vary from prioritizing to assessing planning, implementation, or quality improvement for those medication monitoring mechanisms that are enacted. We can go ahead to the next slide. And as we look here specifically, I'm going to point out three points of variation, or I'm going to speak about three monitoring mechanisms in particular where there was extensive variation. The first here is on mental health expertise. I'll then speak to the psychotropic medication monitoring mechanisms that are in place, and then to the informed consent process. So with regard to the mental health expertise in place, what might be available to a state varied considerably, and to the state child welfare agency in particular. The mental health expertise could be hired staff within the agency, and if you look to the figure on this slide, you'll see that there could be a medical and mental health director within the state child welfare agency. And in about a quarter of their states, there was both a medical and mental health director within the state child welfare agency. But in about 40% of the states, there was neither a medical nor a mental health director in place. In moving and thinking about other ways that these mental health expertise could be available to a child welfare agency, they may also be staff partnering with the state agency. From another state agency. So this could be a medical director within a Medicaid agency, or it could be a mental health director within a state mental health entity or managed care organization. And as well, there were consultants that were also available that were external to the state systems that might have existed within an academic medical center. Next slide, please. And one area where we found considerable variation was with regard to the different types of monitoring mechanisms that states had in place. And if you look at the slide here, what we've done is we've really tried to emphasize in a child-centered way the different parts of a decision to prescribe a psychotropic medication, which begin when the child first enters into foster care and then receives mental health screening and or assessment. This may happen when they first enter into foster care or at any moment thereafter should a concern arise or there be a routine checkup or appointment. And at this time, the clinician might recommend a medication. And prior to prescribing that medication, they first must acquire consent by the person provided with or vested with authority as the consenting individual. This going to that notion of in locus parentis or serving as role of the parent by the child welfare agency that Dr. Leslie had mentioned earlier. So the individual who is vested with the authority to consent then may provide that consent, at which point the medication then may be dispensed and then we would anticipate administration. Go to the next slide, please. And one of the things that our research has highlighted is that there really are, for children in foster care, because of the number of youth-serving systems with which they interface, there are a number of different types of mechanisms that may be in place in providing for the oversight of the psychotropic medication that they are prescribed. And as is indicated in red here, there are three mechanisms that could be in place prior to dispensing the medication. The first two, collegial secondary review and judicial review, are really processes that are part of the informed consent for the use of the medication. And collegial secondary review can rely on a consultant to the consenter that has mental health and medical expertise that provides a review of the whether or not there is safe and judicious use of that medication, and then we'll make a recommendation to the individual who is vested with the consenting authority. And in the second case of judicial review, it's a reliance on a judge within the court system that can then determine as to whether or not the prescribing of that medication is appropriate, and then will provide consent or not. And then following having issued consent, the states also have prior authorization in place, which is typically employed by either a Medicaid or managed care entity, and would include a review of any number of different safety indicators. And if the safety indicator is triggered, then there might be a what we would call a hard edit and the inability to prescribe the medication without first having a review and possibly a medical necessity form completed by that prescribing physician. Following the dispensing of the medication, as you'll see in blue on the slide, there can be a concurrent review while the child is anticipated to be being administered the medication. And we found that there were four different types of concurrent reviews. There could be a database review, which would include drug utilization reviews that a Medicaid or managed care entity might have in place, as well as include a review of a database that a child welfare agency might endorse. And have from within their own agency's system. And as well, the concurrent review might include a caseworker review in which the caseworker will, at their own discretion, determine whether or not there are concerning medications being prescribed and then take action accordingly. There may also be interdisciplinary team meetings with mental health expertise as part of the review process for a child being prescribed psychotropic medication. And then there are routine administrative case reviews in place by different state agencies. Next slide, please. And if we look here to informed consent, what you can see is that the location of where the consenting authority is and how consent is provided might vary across different state agencies. On the far left, you'll see that the consent can be provided at the point of the clinical encounter in some states by the caregiver who is at the appointment with the prescriber and the youth. And in other cases, the consenting authority might sit within the child welfare agency and rely instead on the child welfare worker, the child welfare administrator, or a unit within the child welfare agency where there is mental health expertise, typically led by a child and adolescent psychiatrist. On the other hand, the consent may be further away from that clinical encounter and external to the child welfare agency, relying on either the biological parent or the court system, as I mentioned earlier. Notably, for these different consenting processes, there may be different supports or resources available to the individual who provides consent. This could include training for the consenting individual, consultations available around mental health and around psychotropic medications particularly, and also decision aids that could be available to help inform that decision-making process. Next slide. And then there's just to summarize that there are about 53% of the states employed both a prospective and concurrent review for the psychotropic medication monitoring mechanisms that were in place. However, at the same time, about 12% of the states, or six altogether, had neither a prospective nor a concurrent review process in place for psychotropic medication use. And next slide. And 20% of the monitoring mechanisms that we identified nationally did not routinely have a licensed health professional that provided the review of the safety concerns for the psychotropic medication use. Next slide. And now I'm just going to conclude with some of the structures that were in place to support the development of these psychotropic medication monitoring approaches, and in particular, the role of the interagency collaborations. We looked specifically at six states. Each of these six states had at least two interagency collaborations that they reported were in place to inform oversight efforts, and over half were meeting at least monthly since they were convened. Next. And these served very important roles in the context of the narrative information that we received from the respondents for our study. They talked about these interagency collaborations facilitating exchanges of expertise, values, and beliefs. Here is one example. We had a pharmacist that went with us to the summit, and her whole expertise is different from mine. She would ask questions about how do you want to monitor these medications? Do you want to look for kids that are on 3, 4, or 5 medications? And are those the outliers? She's already thinking about those things, so that's important. Next. And they also highlighted the transfers of discipline-specific research evidence, so that they brought different disciplinary expertise and that they relied on different types of research evidence to inform their efforts. And in this quote, I'll just go to the bolded portion where the respondent says that we have different literature, things that sort of strike our fancy. There are other things that some of the other folks are going to find where I probably wouldn't have even noticed it. And the next slide. And there are also opportunities to appeal for and ultimately leverage the resources that the other agencies that were part of these collaborations might have to bear. And in this case, the child welfare respondent says that child welfare doesn't have all the money that some of the other places have. But we are trying to, like from my perspective, making the case. And there's not a hard case to make that this is a population where Medicaid could save money and improve care. And so just to summarize, that we found considerable state variation in our work nationally, and that variation really well may be appropriate for the local contexts within state agencies are operating. There is limited evidence that exists as to the comparative effectiveness of the existing state approaches, and that it does become critical for us to evaluate for both the intended and the unintended consequences or outcomes of these programs. This is two examples that decreased use of medications with no increase in the rates of psychosocial treatments may lead to more placement disruptions or to greater use of residential care. And that would, of course, be an unintended consequence if the delivery system isn't adequately developed to support a reduction in the medication use. And the oversight of antipsychotics may lead to higher use of other classes of medications like mood stabilizers, which may or may not be as effective for the presenting condition.
Thank you so much, Tom and Laurel, for the great overview that you've provided and all the questions that you've got us thinking about. Thank you so much for all the questions that you've raised for us, and we now turn to the audience for any questions that you might have for Tom or for Laurel. At this point, you can just type it into the question box, and I will pose those to Tom and Laurel. Laurel, just one question for you at the outset. Given that a child's outcomes can be shaped by a lack of coordination across sectors, for example, Medicaid and mental health systems, what are some of your thoughts on ways to improve coordination across these sectors?
Muted.
So that's some of the things that Tom and I were looking at in this study was how to improve collaboration and different types of strategies that states can take. Tom mentioned some of them, just learning how different organizations and different systems would approach a question. There's also learning how to use data better that you have accessible to you, and Chris Belanci will be talking about that some. A number of states have been figuring out how to use data from Medicaid so that they can better understand the medication needs and experiences of children in the child welfare system, particularly those that are in foster care. I think also there are a number of different models that people are beginning to look at with respect to how do you help different systems to understand each other and work better together. So I could talk about that in more detail, but I don't want to close off other questions. But ways of doing joint trainings, for example, with early intervention providers and child welfare workers, sharing access to data systems so that you can have access to information that the other organization has, having parents as partners that help to have foster parents or biological parents be able to navigate the system. There's a lot of work that New York City's been doing around parent partners. Those would be just some examples.
Great. Thank you. Great. Thank you so much, Laurel. And I do apologize if we have a little bit of an echo on this line. A question for Tom. Tom, currently there is limited evidence on the effectiveness of existing state approaches. Such research is critical to evaluating intended and unintended outcomes. What are some areas of research you'd like to see undertaken to address the challenges that we currently face?
This is a great question, and I'll start by just giving recognition to the fact that a lot of states are in fact doing this research within the context of their own the development of their respective approaches, and so they're doing really admirable work partnering between, for example, the Child Welfare Agency and the Medicaid Agency to allow the ability to look at the data that is available within the state to get baseline and then look at over time what the impact might be of a particular monitoring approach that they're implementing is. And so, you know, I can just think to Texas is one state that has publicly available reports that are referenced on a resource list that will be a part of the materials available on the website for this webinar. And so Texas has nice trends data that looks at what has been occurring with regard to the rates of psychotropic medication use as they've implemented different approaches. And so some states are really doing some admirable work in building some evidence for their state around the rates of these, around the potential impact of these monitoring mechanisms that they're implementing within their state and jurisdictions. I think that there's a real need to be looking more towards some of the unintended consequences alongside the intended consequences, and so to look at things like emergency room utilization or substitution effects that I mentioned previously of potential increases in other medications if you're achieving a decrease, for example, in an antipsychotic use because of a prior authorization program, might you see an increase in another class of medications that might not be as clinically indicated or raise additional concerns around the side effects for that other class of medications. So we need to keep thinking about what these unintended consequences might be and ensuring that we look at both those things that we are intending to affect, but also look at those things that might not be as anticipatable at first glance.
Great. Thank you, Tom. And Laurel, I believe you wanted to add some comments as well?
Sometimes we think research needs to be done by researchers sitting in academic medical centers and funded by the NIH or other groups. But what I think a number of us are really excited about is the use of research processes by states themselves to begin to look at their processes and some of the both positive and potentially unintended negative consequences of what they're doing. And Tom's point about variation being appropriate, I had mentioned that variation was concerning, but the variation I was talking about was variation seen in use of medications, which suggests it's hard to imagine that children have such varied mental health needs depending on what state they're in. So that suggests actually issues with access to and use of services and variation at that level. But variation at the local level for figuring out how a system's going to work given your particular context is actually quite appropriate, and that's where research at the state level or partnerships between researchers and states can be so effective.
Great. Thank you
so much,
Laurel.
Thank you so much, Laurel.
We're going to turn now to question three and hear from Chris Belanchi, who's an associate professor at Tufts University School of Medicine, talking about how states are using local evidence collaboratively to measure medication use. So, Chris, we'll turn it over to you now. And if people do have questions, please type them in the questions box. And just to remind you once again, this webinar is being recorded and will be accessible later on our website along with the copies of the PowerPoint. So Chris, over to you.
Thanks, Loretta. So I will be talking a little bit about a psychotropic medication quality improvement collaborative that I was privileged to be a part of, funded by the Annie E. Casey Foundation and led by the Center for Healthcare Strategies. With my colleagues Kamala Allen and Sheila Pyres. And this initiative was launched at around the same time, around 2012, when there was increasing federal support and attention on the issue related to psychotropic medication utilization for foster youth. So it was well-timed, and we saw a very interested and responsive process from the states who applied. We had 27 states apply, and we were only able to fund six for participation in the three-year collaborative. And what we did was invite the states to participate in thinking about what they wanted to promote in terms of best practices for psychotropic medication use. And you heard Dr. Leslie talk about the great variation in utilization nationally. There was a study done by a colleague, Dave Rubin, out of Philadelphia Policy Lab, where we saw a variation in antipsychotic medication use from a low of 2% in Hawaii to as almost 22% in Texas. So almost a tenfold variation in utilization for antipsychotics for this vulnerable population. And that's hard to explain from a clinical perspective, and I am first and foremost a clinician as a child psychiatrist. But that becomes a policy issue that begs questions and responses from the field. And that was what we began to look at in this six-state psychotropic medication quality improvement collaborative. We had states starting at very different places in terms of policy development. And I was able to work with Laurel and Tom in developing, when we did the Tufts study, and looked at what the national policies looked like back in 2010. And we had about two states of the six that had no psychotropic medication consent process. We had two states that were quite advanced in their development of protocols, including New Jersey, and you'll be hearing from Deb Lancaster right after me. And then we had two states that were kind of in between. And that was by design, because we wanted to see what each state was interested in promoting and what state-based responses to the challenge that Laurel and Tom so eloquently constructed for us around concerns about overutilization of psychiatric medications for foster youth. Next slide. So the six states that were participating in the collaborative were Illinois, New Jersey, New York, Oregon, Rhode Island, and Vermont. And the goal for the collaborative was to identify and agree upon common definitions and measures that each state could implement to address the inappropriate use of psychotropic medication. You know, to note, there is no standard definition in research or practice for many of our terms, and I'll go over what we defined for our terms. This became necessary because if we were going to have common outcome measures that we were going to assess over the course of the three-year initiative, we had to have common definitions for how we were defining our terms. And I want to credit New York State's PSYCHES program, which was already developed at the time that we were beginning to look at our data definitions, and we borrowed heavily from New York's excellent work in advance of our initiative. Next slide. So the state approaches included everything from developing or revising informed consent procedures, similar to what Dr. Mackey described, develop method for generating real-time medication utilization data. In some cases, this would come from Medicaid claims. In other cases, some states were actually keeping their own record of what meds, either based on the consents that were coming in or based on what the caseworkers in the child welfare workforce were already aware of the child being prescribed. They would then develop a protocol for reviewing any red flags or outlier prescribing practices based on age, based on dose, based on how long the child is taking the medication, whether the diagnosis matches the class of medication that they're taking, which class of medication is being most utilized, whether there was co-pharmacy. We define that as taking two medications from the same class, for instance, two antipsychotic medications for which there's very little evidence base to suggest that that's appropriate prescribing, and based on polypharmacy. That would be more than one medication, more than one psychiatric medication. So it could be an antidepressant and a stimulant, or an antidepressant and antipsychotic medication. And then the states would develop the oversight and monitoring processes that were most appropriate from their jurisdiction and practice concerns. So in many ways, this was a naturalistic study. We didn't have to make the case for most of these states that the issue of concerns about potential overprescribing of psychiatric medications for foster youth was a concern needing a response. They were already aware of that. And this was more about what were going to be the unique responses that each state would come up with that were appropriate for their systems. Next slide. So psychotropic medications, these are some of the definitions that we used. I'm not going to go through all the definitions, but these are some examples. Psychiatric medications are defined as medications being used for an emotional or behavioral condition. So they're really defined by the purpose. There are some medications that really, their only purpose is for psychiatric indications, like antipsychotic medications. Stimulants are generally for attention deficit hyperactivity disorder. Antidepressants to treat depression. They are also used for anxiety. Benzodiazepines, those are the classes of medicines. Excuse me. Like Ativan or Valium. They're a subset of anti-anxiety medications. And then mood stabilizers, such as lithium, and then also we use anticonvulsants for mood stabilizers. Next slide. This is an example of how we defined dosage guidelines. And what I like about this approach is that it's a very transparent way to let those that are being reviewed around outlier practices. So some states would actually call prescribers who were prescribing either more than one medication from the same class, like two antipsychotic medications, or had kids on four or five medications simultaneously. For the states that actually had physician review processes, they would sometimes get pushback from the prescriber and say, well, what evidence is there that this is bad practice? And what's nice about this kind of an approach is that the reviewer can refer and provide the person doing the prescribing a very clear indication of where these concerns came from. So in the case of dosage, the first place to look would be whether or not the Food and Drug Administration has approval for this use in a pediatric population. Many of the medications we use in child psychiatry are actually being used off-label, meaning that the FDA didn't approve and the pharmaceutical company didn't provide data to the FDA to actually show that these medications are safe for children typically under age 13. Sometimes the indication is under age 10. And so if there's an actual pediatric indication for the medication, then the dosage guideline would be listed in that indication. But where so many of the prescribing practices aren't covered by FDA approval, The second place we would look would be whether there were specific indications for youth, or if there weren't, we would look at guidelines developed by a consensus group such as the one that was convened in Texas. That was in response, actually, to some of that high prescribing that I talked about earlier. They've since brought their prescribing rates down significantly. And this is an example of a way in which you can develop best practice guidelines, implement them, and then see changes in prescribing. Whether or not that actually resulted in better well-being measures for the children in Texas, I'm not sure. And that's, I think, the shift that Tom was suggesting we need to make, that, you know, monitoring to lower utilization is actually not that challenging. We can put in prior authorization processes and limit access, but are the children actually being better served as a result? And we always want to be very cautious about the unintended consequences of some of these utilization processes. So if there's no FDA indication for the pediatric population, we would go to the consensus guidelines, and then if there weren't, if that issue wasn't covered in the consensus guidelines, we actually had a specific textbook that we would access, and if all else failed, the medication would at least have adult dosage guidelines that we could draw upon. Next slide. This pertains to second-generation antipsychotic medications. That's what SGA stands for. These would be medicines like Risperdal, Abilify, Seroquel, Geodon are the brand names. And these are medicines that are associated with significant metabolic risks, including risks for diabetes. And given those risks, there's consensus that it's a requirement that you measure certain lab studies and do certain tests to ensure that the child being put on these medications is not coming to harm. And so we developed the minimum metabolic monitoring guidelines that include, you know, taking a personal and family history of any heart disease, any diabetes risk. You would measure waist circumference. You would get the youth's weight and body mass index periodically. We would check blood pressure, and then we would do actual lab tests, fasting glucose and lipid profile. That would be things like cholesterol and triglycerides, and you can also do a precursor to diabetes risk, hemoglobin A1C measure. And we would then indicate what would be the periodicity that we wanted these labs to be done in. Next slide. And these are the common measures that the group came together to identify that they would monitor over the course of the three-year initiative. So youth who are in foster care on any psychiatric medication, on specific classes of medications, for instance, antidepressants, stimulants, mood stabilizer, on more than one medication from the same class, that's what we called co-pharmacy, on two, three, four, or more psychotropic medications, and each of these were measured discreetly. Less than 6 years old on any psychiatric medication, less than 6 years old on two, three, or four, and less than 6 years old on antipsychotic medications. And sadly, there were certainly children that were less than 6 years old taking antipsychotic medications. Next slide. And then we had two qualitative measures where we were also measuring the implementation of evidence-based or promising interventions for sleep disorders and/or aggression, with the idea that those were indications that were often driving the use of antipsychotic medications. And then also the development of an informed consent process or increased adherence if the state already had an established informed consent process. So those were the measures that we looked at over the course of the three-year initiative and then at the conclusion, so that we can then look at and try to start getting data to indicate which approach is best, because I've been approached as a consultant by a number of states asking, well, what should we do? And unfortunately, we don't have good data to say, well, this is the system that seems to be resulting in the best outcomes for children. We can now start showing some states that are, have lower utilization versus higher utilization, but what's associated with that, since this is really more about correlation and not causation in looking at the data and then trying to extrapolate that to the well-being measures, I think that's the future work. Next slide. And here I'll turn it over to my colleague, Deb Lancaster.
Thank you for having New Jersey as part of this webinar. You can go to the next slide. I want to share the context within which New Jersey decided to focus on developing psychotropic medication policy. New Jersey actually embarked on this effort prior to the GAO report coming out. And our motivation came from several places, including recognition that the feds would eventually require additional oversight. But our primary motivation stemmed from a concern about the number of children on psychotropic medications as we began looking at Medicaid claims data. We had a healthy internal debate about how to approach oversight and monitoring. We ultimately agreed we would develop and implement a policy that was grounded in the research evidence to the extent that there was evidence, and that it be aligned with our existing child health plan and the child health values we had articulated as a department as part of our overall reform efforts that we already had underway. For one, as a state-run child welfare agency, we made a commitment to implementing a case practice model that emphasized family strengths and engagement and teaming with biological families and their informal and formal supports. In the area of child health for children in foster care, we made an intentional decision and commitment to leverage healthcare resources in the community and not create what we might call foster care islands of healthcare. Our goal is to maintain or establish continuity of care for a child with their primary care and subspecialists as they transition in and out of care and keep children within their existing Medicaid HMO whenever possible. When children enter foster care, most parents retain the right to make decisions on behalf of their children. Non-routine medical care and decision-making requires the consent quite often of the biological parent, including psychotropic medication prescribing. Most children in foster care return home, and from our perspective, parents really need to be well positioned and supported in learning what their access or learning what their children's physical and behavioral health needs are and need to be able to access and navigate appropriate care for their children. In 2006-2007, we made an investment in developing and implementing child health units in each of our 47 child welfare offices, staffed with RNs and staff assistants to provide healthcare case management to every child and youth in out-of-home placement. This allowed us to truly operationalize our child health values and gave us boots on the ground to ensure children were getting the preventative and specialty care they needed. I'll touch base more about the child health units next. Or later. Next slide, please. When we began to conceptualize policy development, we engaged in a simultaneous process of reviewing existing professional guidelines and existing policies from other states and jurisdictions. Our policy is grounded in available evidence and what is understood to be best or good or sometimes just reasonable practice, a lot of which is synthesized in existing guidelines issued by the American Association of Child and Adolescent Psychiatrists, the American Academy of Pediatrics, and the Child Welfare League of America. We also cannot ignore the growing body of research regarding the impact of trauma on the brain and on overall well-being. Finally, we decided to rely upon the FDA guidelines for articulating our prescribing parameters. FDA guidelines are conservative and informed by the research evidence available for drug utilization in children. Our policy, similar to that of ACAP guidelines, recommends beginning with medications that have been FDA approved for a child's given age group and diagnosis before progressing to other medications. Medications that have more data regarding safety and efficacy are preferred over newly FDA approved medications and so forth. We crosswalked policies of other states and jurisdictions against each other and began drafting a policy for New Jersey, again, being mindful of our existing policies around consent and our overarching approach to child health, which emphasized leveraging local resources and local decision-making. We formed an internal work group to get input and achieve buy-in from areas of the department that would be impacted by the policy and its implementation. Psychotropic medication utilization is an area that makes many people uncomfortable, particularly our child welfare managers. And we were about to ask a child welfare system already under the microscope, like so many are, to own the decision-making process for children in a way in which they hadn't done before. And we're asking them to partner with parents and clinicians and our child health unit nurses to ask questions that reasonable parents might ask, or to help parents ask those questions. We were adding complexity to their already complex workload. But we were also committed to developing understanding and provide training and education to the frontline staff and managers about the role medications can play in treatment and how to ask the right questions at the right time. We relied on the research base to help us develop understanding among staff and stakeholders and had to work at disseminating the research for a range of different audiences. We also formed a Commissioner's Psychotropic Medication Advisory Group. We wanted this group not just to bless or rubber stamp our draft policy, but really be thought partners in highlighting anything we missed in helping us implement the policy and assist us with keeping it relevant and up to date. Just a word on our policy, it's pretty standard fare. In fact, there was very little to disagree with among prescribers in New Jersey. Some were a little irritated that they were now being kind of questioned about their prescribing practices, but most welcomed this as an opportunity to partner with child welfare in a way they had not done as consistently in the past. Next slide, please. So the key components of our policy in New Jersey, and I've already touched base on a number of them, but I'll start with psychiatric evaluation. So before a child or youth is prescribed a psychotropic medication because we think that might be something that might help with treatment or to address a target symptom, et cetera. Before a medication is started, we have that child or youth see a appropriate medical professional. So in New Jersey, that's considered in our policy a child adolescent psychiatrist, preferably. We do allow them to see psychiatrists who do not have that board certification if need be, or something like a neurodevelopmental pediatrician, depending on how the child is presenting. So that's something that we require for all children, especially given their trauma histories, and we want to rule out anything organic, et cetera. Authorized prescribers in New Jersey are really limited to psychiatrists, and with the exception of non-complicated ADHD, where we do allow that prescribing to be done by pediatricians. Every child on a psychotropic medication must have a treatment plan, which includes a non-pharmacological intervention. I mean, it needs to be an up-to-date treatment plan, and we need to have it in the record. We prefer, obviously, that the non-pharmacological intervention is evidence-supported or evidence-informed, and we're still working on that in New Jersey, and obviously one that's appropriate to support the child and their family. Informed consent must be up-to-date and documented, and then I've touched base on the medication guidelines already and the prescribing parameters, which are really drawn from the FDA. And we also do have safety monitoring guidelines that focuses on kind of what tests need to be done and how to monitor for metabolic syndromes and et cetera. So next slide, please. One of the things that has become clear to me, solidified by the PMQIC work Christopher referenced, is that child welfare agencies have to be strategic about leveraging and building structural supports required to do this work in a meaningful way. Medication oversight must be part of a broader plan and approach to child health and well-being and must be in service to improving outcomes for children and families. While states and jurisdictions may have policies that have similar goals and similar components in many instances, state approaches to this work will and probably should vary. DCF here in New Jersey has a number of key structural supports in place that informed and assisted with our policy development and the ongoing implementation. Firstly, we're a state-administered child welfare system, so that's relevant because we can make policy and implement things at a state level and have that done across every county. And so that has some benefits, I think, in this situation. But anyway, we at least were mindful of that in our structure as we developed the policy. All children in New Jersey are enrolled in New Jersey Medicaid HMOs. In New Jersey, we have a number of them, four or five, that serve our Medicaid population, and our children in foster care are on those same HMOs. And like I said, many times they go back to their families. Many children in foster care return home, so if we can keep them with the same position, if that's appropriate, we try and do that. We have a fairly mature children's system of care, or children's behavioral health system, where especially when you see children and youth who are on psychotropic medication, particularly who may be experiencing polypharmacy, there's lots of crossover with children in foster care and children enrolled in our children's system of care. These children also have care managers from the children's system of care. We have the child health units, which I already touched base about, and we have one plus full-time child adolescent psychiatrist. And more recently, while maybe not a structural support, we had support of the PMQIC group that Dr. Belanci referenced. And this was a real opportunity for us to push ourselves and create some time and space and momentum after our initial policy development implementation, and also learn a great deal from other states. Next slide, please. New Jersey's child health units have been a real bright spot in our reform efforts and have gotten the attention of many in the field. Every child has a medical home and a child health unit nurse. They are up to date with immunizations and well child visits and receive semi-annual dental care. And again, these are our children in foster care. Each child and youth has a health passport, and nurses visit with foster families and work with biological parents to engage them in the health care of their child. They gather records, communicate with clinicians, ask questions, and provide anticipatory guidance within their scope of work. Our caseworkers and foster families find them to be extremely valuable partners, and they work with our child and adolescent psychiatrists and our local office staff when a child or youth may require medication as part of their treatment plan. Next slide, please. We've also found it really important to invest in a full-time child adolescent psychiatrist through a partnership with the university here in New Jersey. It's really been essential to lift this work up and sustain our efforts. So she sees, she's available for consultation to, just to keep it simple, to almost anyone who has a question. But the cases typically referred for consultation include children under six, three or more psychotropic medications, the child has a complicating medical illness, or that the medication is not approved for a child's diagnosis. And she case conferences on a lot of our, with our child health unit nurses and our caseworkers, et cetera. Next slide, please. And then this is just a little bit of information about how we monitor and track our data. So the nurses keep child health unit trackers, this is some of the information that they collect and that we then analyze and do some quality assurance on. And then we also use it to pull and review at-risk cohorts of children or children that we might see as even more at-risk. And take a look at that data on a quarterly basis. It allows us to review every child prescribed a medication on a quarterly basis. Next slide, please. And I just want to wrap up by saying that our ongoing work includes a commitment to continue our close collaboration with our children's system of care and to understand if the non-pharmacological interventions that children, youth, and families participate in are, in fact, the right interventions, and that also as a next step, we're focused on integrating more evidence-supported programming and treatment into our child welfare service array. Thank you.
Great. Thank you so much to both of you for your presentations. I just want to point out, as we will be going to Q&A in just a minute, that we're really keen to today underscore that we're really focused on this intersection between research policy and practice. And so if you do have questions related to that, we welcome your questions at this time. I also want to point out that on the slide deck, we will have numerous references listed. So if you're looking for any further information, please look at those references. And on the AYPF website, we will be posting our resources related to today's event, as was mentioned earlier. I'm going to leave the slide up that thanks all of our presenters so that you can see their contact information as we now move to the Q&A part. And I believe all of our presenters should be unmuted. So I first want to turn to Chris and just ask you a question that's come in, Chris. Some medications have pediatric dosage guidelines that are approved by the Food and Drug Administration, as you noted. Do you think the FDA needs to be more active in this sphere, providing dosage guidelines for more pediatric medications?
That's a really important question, and I appreciate the questioner. I think that would be great because as a prescriber, I don't always have access to the information I need in order to meet the clinical needs of the population that I'm being asked to serve. There have been efforts at increasing research on the safety and efficacy of these medications. Efficacy means does the medication do what is being marketed? And safety, of course, means that it's specifically been tested for safety within this age group. The FDA Modernization Act did allow the FDA to actually require pharmaceutical companies to test for safety and efficacy if the medication was clearly going to have a pediatric indication. They also allow an extra 6 months of patent, so exclusive marketing to the pharmaceutical company, if they test for safety and efficacy. So it's a bit of a carrot and stick approach. The carrot is the incentive, which for a particularly widely used medication could bring in millions extra for the pharmaceutical company. The stick would be the requirement before it's allowed to be on the market that the pharmaceutical company would have to test for safety and efficacy. You know, it's hard to do these studies. I don't know how many of our listeners have children, but if I had you in an audience, I'd ask you by a raise of hands, how many of you would be willing to have your child be the one enrolled for the safety study of this new medication? So obviously there's ethical concerns, there's costs associated with the additional research, but you know, some estimates are that as much as 75% of psychiatric or medications being used for children, not just psychiatric medications, but this is true for pediatricians as well, are being used off-label, either for an age group that hasn't specifically been tested for safety or for an indication that hasn't been tested for efficacy. Some of the medications I use are blood pressure medicines, or I mentioned anticonvulsants as mood stabilizers. They were tested for their approved indication, either to lower blood pressure or to control seizures, but not for bipolar disorder, like I'm using the anticonvulsants, or the blood pressure medicines, like I'm using for ADHD. So, you know, there's an urgent need, and part of the challenge is that some of the studies are done and then not published because actually there were more side effects than were anticipated, or it's not clear that the benefits are actually better than the risks, and those studies get buried, either by the pharmaceutical company that doesn't choose to publish them, or the journals that don't want to publish negative outcomes. So it's a real challenge to the field to have quality research data on the safety and efficacy of these medications. And you know, I encourage people to take a look at the slide that Dr. Leslie presented from the REACH Institute that shows the dearth of evidence base around safety and efficacy for a number of these psychiatric medications that we're using in large volumes, particularly for foster youth.
Chris, Thank you so much, Chris. Yeah, and Laurel, do you want to just jump in and add anything more?
Yes, I just wanted to add 2 points to that. A lot of the data, as Chris is pointing out, going back to that slide, we have good data for short-term studies, you know, 6 to 16 weeks, but we don't have a lot of good long-term data because that's harder to get. And then what was really lacking is any research on polypharmacy. Even two medications together, those studies are relatively rare. So that is something we as the public should be pushing for and requesting, is more research in general on kids' psychotropic medications, more long-term studies, and more studies that are looking at combinations of medications.
Thank you so much, Laurel. Tom, I don't know if you wanted to add anything before we move off this question.
Oh, I would just agree with both of the comments of Dr. Leslie and Balanci.
Okay. Thank you. Deb, I wanted to turn to you and thank you so much for the presentation on what's going on in New Jersey. You had mentioned that you had to work at disseminating the research for different audiences. And I wonder if you can talk a little bit more about that, how you went about doing that, because I think that's one of the things we're intrigued by in this topic today, is that dissemination of research, and we know that different people are going to approach the research differently. So if you can talk a little bit about what New Jersey did in relation to this?
Sure. Well, it might. So we had for the audiences that we needed to. There was the child health units, right? So they have a kind of nursing slash clinical lens. We had our prescribing community, and although we do have limits on who can prescribe, as I mentioned earlier, I would say that the primary audience there were child adolescent psychiatrists and a handful of advanced practice nurses. And then we had our caseworkers, who are our frontline staff, boots on the ground, up through our local office managers. And so, you know, we wanted to be kind of evidence, I guess, using that term very broadly, that we use to more or less, to different extents with those stakeholder groups. Included, you know, some of our administrative data, which I realize is not research evidence, but I think it helps kind of highlight, you know, some of the reasons we are doing this work. And even more importantly was kind of just bringing to bear the studies, some of which my colleagues have mentioned, about the unevenness in prescribing, kind of the role that medication plays, and the limits of that, kind of the ACAP guidelines. So that's the kind of research evidence, and also really educating, because I think that there's some, we wanted to make sure that folks didn't see this, you know, medicine is good or bad. But that, you know, what's the right role it can play. And kind of, you know, our child adolescent psychologist, Dr. Mary Byrne, who I've worked very closely with on this, and this isn't, you know, exactly, and she could say it much better than I can, but she would do a presentation, especially for our non-clinical folks and our nurses who maybe didn't have a lot of experience in this arena, which is probably most of them in the beginning, about like what depression feels like. What does it feel like to have ADHD? You know, what is the role that medication plays in some of these common common diagnoses that some of our children have, just to try and really build an understanding about the important role and the right role that medication can play. And at the same time, I think she would talk about, you know, what about our kids that have oppositional defiant disorder, you know, and try and unpack that a little bit, and where that diagnosis might come from and the role of trauma and why it's important to, you know, gather histories, et cetera. So I'm not sure if that helps answer the question, but, you know, that's like we wanted to get these different stakeholder groups on board and really develop an understanding about why we're doing this, what is informing some of our decision and our direction, et cetera.
Thank you so much, Deb, and I really appreciate you giving us that very concrete example of what does depression feel like. So when you're busy trying to educate a certain populace, and like you mentioned, talking to nurses and getting them on board with this latest research. I want to also ask you, Deb, there's a question that's come in about whether you can comment on the supply, availability, and weight for psychiatrists who accept Medicaid or whatever funding is being used by DCF.
Right, so this is a real challenge across the country, and it's not, it's, you know, we have this challenge in New Jersey too. So what New Jersey, what we have going for us, I think, relative to some colleagues I've talked with in some other jurisdictions at least, is we do have, you know, an okay amount of child adolescent psychiatrists. The challenge is, of course, as the person who posed the question, I'm sure, is well aware, many of our child adolescent psychiatrists do not take Medicaid. So sometimes we find ourselves using state-only dollars or kind of other program, like if we have a cost reimbursement contract with a provider who's also providing therapeutic intervention, there might be a portion of that contract that is retained to have a consulting child adolescent psychiatrist. So that's how we sometimes pay for them, in addition to the kind of mental health clinics and Medicaid resources that are out there, which really are limited. And so I'm being really honest, and I know this is being recorded, but we find ways to work around it until rates change or until, you know, more child and adolescent psychiatrists come online, et cetera. So, but fortunately, we felt like we did have enough of them, and that I understand that not everyone might be positioned to only allow child adolescent psychiatrists to do our prescribing, but our data has indicated for quite some time that those are the folks that in fact do the large majority of prescribing, at least in New Jersey. But we do recognize the challenge with that particular work.
Well, if I may.
Jump in, yep.
This is Chris Belanti. I think New Jersey is also a great example where they have implemented statewide implementation of systems of care. So they have a well-developed community mental health system, because this isn't just about limiting access of psychiatric medications to foster youth. It's really about providing the most appropriate mental health services and supports for foster youth, which may or may not include psychiatric medications. I think the psychiatric medications are sometimes an indicator that there's a problem with your service delivery field. It may be an access issue, but it may be access to evidence-based psychosocial therapies, which particularly for foster youth are critical, because almost invariably these youth have some form of trauma, whether it was the trauma that led to the removal or the trauma that they experienced from the removal, from everything that they hold dear, their families, their communities, their schools. And so to not also include a trauma perspective in this conversation or the discussion about evidence-based psychosocial therapies, I think would be a disservice to the conversation. And I think New Jersey, which I believe has some of the lowest utilization rates that I've seen nationally, it's not just because they have a well-developed oversight and monitoring system, they also have a really well-developed community mental health system, which I know Deb has mentioned, but I just wanted to underscore.
Thank you so much, Chris. And was that Laurel trying to jump in?
Oh, no, it's Deb. I was just going to say, absolutely, this is Deb, and absolutely. And Chris, thank you so much. That's super important. This really isn't just about medication. I mean, it's about access to treatment, and that children's system of care is, we believe, has really been key in addressing lowering our numbers.
Thank you, Deb. And I just had a question here that relates, and it's very interesting just given what Chris just talked about. So the question is, it's relatively long, but I think it's well worth examining. It's one of our questioners is saying, are there thoughts or research efforts that will look at potential level of service typologies? For example, are there differences in medication use between general population children receiving services in their own homes and out-of-home children? There is some thinking states are only bringing in the more difficult and likely more needing medication children, but their children at home do have similar needs. Could this reveal that state entry practices could have some explanation for geographic differences? And I know, Tom, I think you had touched on some of that work. I don't know if you want to take a stab at commenting on that observation.
Well, I think it's a very good point that, and I really appreciate the question, that what will work, what might be most effective in terms of a monitoring approach might very much vary, dependent upon the way that the child welfare system operates within a particular state. And so, you know, this is one of the reasons that there's such a challenge in these effectiveness studies, because child welfare agencies operate in such different ways, and the trajectory of entry into those systems can look so different, even within a state where they might be county administered versus being state administered, as Deb Lancaster has mentioned earlier, is the case in New Jersey. And so I think looking towards, the differences in terms of, in a more nuanced way, is really a valuable way to look at this. And we do have some, there's some data sets that are better suited, thinking of NSCA in particular, to look at those kinds of questions because they get a larger sample of kids who are both in foster care but then also child welfare involved. So it's a great point and does bring in to relief some of the important nuance that needs to be taken into consideration in thinking about what might work best given the different trajectories for children who are involved with and in foster care.
Great. Thank you so much, Tom. I want to turn to our last question because this is going to go to each of our presenters. And the question is, and it sort of relates to something that was mentioned earlier, I think raised by Tom and Chris, this need to think more about measuring for well-being. And so the question is, what do our presenters recommend for next steps for oversight and monitoring? How can oversight agencies better respond to the concerns raised by the GAO reports? And I think we'll take it from the top. Laurel, if you'd like to respond first.
So I'm going to respond wearing my hat as a pediatrician and then also my hat as a parent. So I'm going to less focus on systems issues and let some of the others talk about those. But we are moving in medicine in general towards a shared decision-making perspective where we're trying to really work to empower people who are receiving treatments to be active participants in both making the decision about that treatment as well as monitoring outcomes. And I think the quotes from those two youth that I presented demonstrate that youth can be very good at assessing whether something is helping or not in conjunction with other people that are part of their lives, including the caregivers and teachers at schools that are working with them, coaches, etc. So one of the things that the Administration on Children and Families has done is they're really working to try to empower youth to be able to understand the medications they're on, the psychosocial treatments they're getting, what they're there for, so that they can be better consumers of the system. And we don't want this to start when these kids are at the point of aging out of the system. We're really trying to push this in pediatrics for starting with children who are early in puberty and beginning to move into adolescence for those children that have chronic medical conditions. Because they're going to have to function as adults to navigate the healthcare and mental health system, and they're going to have to understand the challenges that they're bringing into their own ability to function as adults in a system. So I think some of the things that I would recommend would be engaging youth in thinking through what are measures for well-being and in being partners in their care. And this is something we don't tend to do in foster care at all. It's very easy, again, because of the number of adults involved, to have a child feel like they have less control, not only about their health care, but it's also about their placement.
Thank you so much, Laurel. Tom, would you like to respond?
Yes, absolutely. So, you know, I think one of the things that struck me in conducting this research is the extent to which the successful states are really collaborating across their youth-serving agencies at the state or county level. And I think that for me was a major take-home point from the research that we've conducted to date, is that, you know, Medicaid sits as the payer of services for children in foster care predominantly. Mental health is the providing the license and the service delivery training for those with the most severe conditions usually. And child welfare has custody of the child that is in state that is in foster care. And so they each arrive to the table with real different roles and resources to bring to this issue. And so the extent to which, you know, those collaborations can be leveraged and maximized and opportunities, you know, to develop robust, as we've discussed earlier, robust systems of care for children broadly and then those in foster care specifically, is a real important part of seeking out the solution and also the opportunity to measure whether or not it's effective. So by providing an engagement across those agencies, you also increase the types of data and the information that you can look at with regard to how effective these approaches have been. So I guess I would just emphasize the message that has been really given even by the federal government in the context of the of of the original sets of legislation that enacted, as well as of the Because Mind Matters Summit that had been mentioned earlier, which is that a state is going to be well served by having those in the child serving agencies work collaboratively in developing both a comprehensive and holistic response and an evaluation effort to measure its effectiveness.
Thank you so much, Tom. We turn to Chris.
And I'll try to be really brief because I know we're almost out of time, but as much as I'm seduced by the potential of so-called big data and wanting to be able to get real-time data from Medicaid claims to inform our prescribing oversight and monitoring, I was reminded when I was consulting in Virginia and working with Fairfax County that you can also do this in a very local, very low-tech way. You can actually ask the kids, what meds are you taking? Are the medicines helpful? Do you understand why you're taking them? You can ask the foster parents, are these medicines seeming to help? Are you getting more benefits than side effects? You can ask the caseworkers, do you have concerns about the medicines that your child is taking? Are you even aware of what medicines the child is being prescribed? So there's ways to get the data to come from the bottom up as well as from the top down.
Thank you so much, Chris. And we'll have Deborah with a last word.
And I'll be quick. So I think this concept of well-being is really important, and just to kind of piggyback on what Christopher said, I think that we're trying, physical health, nutrition, rest and sleep, home, family, school and community relationships, those are all kind of things we can observe and engage our young people about and, gather some of that data. So when I think of well-being, I think of it's something that our casework staff, our parents, caregivers, need to know about in our physicians. And I think kind of developing capacity to engage our young people and our caregivers in these various domains of well-being will be important. I mean, at the end of the day, I think sometimes it's hard to tell, unless you're in a study, whether or not it's the medicine, the therapy, the home, a coach that's helping a child get better. But I think we need to know about all of those things. Is this child getting better? Is it the treatment plan? Is it being implemented? And what's the impact of that? I mean, that's ultimately what we want at the end of the day is for the medicine, the therapy, the intervention to be having its intended impact or a positive impact. If it's not the intended impact, then try and understand what that is.
Well, thank you so much, Deb, and I just want to thank all of you for just raising our awareness today of the importance of the partnerships and collaboration that need to happen as we develop these robust systems of care, the research that needs to still be taking place and that we still need to pursue, and also the efforts we need to engage in to make that research accessible to the different stakeholders, and more importantly, getting youth to be active partners in their own well-being and thinking about how we can gather the data not only from the top down but from the bottom up and make that accessible to a range of individuals as we really look to improve the outcomes for young people. Once again, please join me in thanking Chris, Deborah, Tom, and Laurel for all that they have shared today. We really appreciate you taking the time to join us to listen to their wisdom and expertise, and we'd greatly appreciate it if you could fill out the survey on exiting the webinar, which will only help make our future events even better. Once again, the materials and recording will be posted online.